So I went to go see Winchester today, starring Helen Mirren, Jason Clarke, Sarah Snook, our boy Angus Sampson from Insidious. This is a new movie directed by the Spierig brothers, who did other films like Predestination and Daybreakers, which are very critically acclaimed. This is a haunted house horror movie based on the haunted Winchester Mansion, which is a real mansion that exists in the United States that is supposedly very haunted. Now, one thing I don't really talk about on this channel, even though some folks probably want me to, is that I really love paranormal stuff. Like, I have reviewed horror films before, but I actually like, you know, unsolved mysteries and conspiracies. And, you know, years ago, if you've been a longtime follower of mine before Geekdom 101, before World of Geekdom, you know that I've covered these topics on different podcasts. But the thing about the Winchester home is that I didn't know much about it, to be honest with you. I have read things here and there, and I'm pretty sure I saw an episode of Sightings or Unsolved Mysteries way back in the 90s. Only the old folks remember that show. Fun times, but they really don't hold up anymore. Well, Unsolved Mysteries is still great, but Sightings doesn't really hold up. But I'm pretty sure I saw a little bit of the Winchester home, but I'm not an expert in this, so I went into this movie not really knowing much about the real story. And the movie pretty much follows the story of Helen Mirren playing the part of Sarah Winchester, who, well, people think she's going crazy because she is claiming there is a curse put on her house, and you really don't find this out until later on in the movie. And they send a psychologist in there, which is played by Jason Clarke, to check and make sure that she's still mentally fit to run the company. Now, what company am I talking about? I'm talking about the Winchester Rifle Company, and that really is the plot of this film, is that the Winchester Company, the one that manufactures the rifles, the ghosts, I guess you can say, or the demons, whatever you want to call them, are haunting the house, and they are coming after the Winchester bloodline because some of the ghosts are blaming the Winchester family for the deaths of not only themselves, but also their family members. And the plot, of course, unravels from there, and you find out who these ghosts are and what their actual motives are as the film goes through. There's actually a pretty interesting twist about halfway through that really kind of, you know, nails home something that you're not really suspecting it, to be honest, but you kind of are a little bit. You know, when it happened, it's like, oh, okay, that makes sense, but it's not really a big, you know, shocker, but it was a cool shocker, so I'm going to give them credit on that. But basically, the Winchester family, and this is all, you know, supposedly based on a true story, because the Winchesters did exist, this house does exist, these characters, you know, like Sarah Winchester also exists, but by the end of the movie, you can tell it took a lot of liberties here, and obviously the real story, about halfway through, I would say probably about two-thirds of the way through the movies when we start going into fantasy land. It's very similar to what happened with The Conjuring 2, because in The Conjuring 2, you know, it's based on the Enfield poltergeist, and there's truth to that story, you know, obviously if you believe in it, based on the actual accounts, but then James Wan goes in there, and he really picks apart the reality and starts adding a lot of stuff that wasn't in the original story just to make it an entertaining movie. Those things don't really bother me, but it's important that you understand when you leave that movie theater that not everything you see actually happened. And I think a lot of younger people and people who are, I don't know, they don't really think, a lot of people think that when they see a movie and it says based on a true story, that the entire movie's based on a true story, when actually it's more so inspired by events and, of course, you know, propped up and made into a movie. Now, Sarah Winchester, played by Helen Mirren, is not the main character here. It is Jason Clarke. The story is told by his perspective. She is the secondary main character, but she plays a very, very important role in the film. Now, obviously, the reason you clicked on this video is probably because you're wondering, is this movie worth seeing? Is it scary? And I gotta be honest with you, it's, you know, my duty as a film reviewer here on World of Geekdom is, you know, I'm very cognizant of people out there and their hard-earned dollar. And so if you're clicking on this video, I want to make sure I tell you the truth about whether or not you should spend your money. And the reality is, I don't think you should spend your money on this movie. If you have a movie pass, fine. If you want to wait for Redbox or Netflix, that's fine. This is not a very good movie. And actually, before I started reviewing this movie, just out of curiosity, I went to go look at the Rotten Tomatoes score, and it's at 13%. Now, I'll be honest with you, it's really not that bad. But the movie tends to drag and is very, very dull. Even though you have Helen Mirren in there, who's a legendary actress, Jason Clarke was very hit or miss, Both of them come off very bored in this movie. The movie relies too much, I think, on exposition, and the first half or so of the film is really, it drags. I mean, this thing freaking drags and drags and drags. They'll show you a couple of, let's be honest, predictable scares that they took from the James Wan playbook. We've seen these so many times for the past 10 years. Hell, I would even say 30 years. They're reusing the same scares over again that we've seen before, and it's very predictable, but it just, the movie feels very empty. The movie feels very, like, get on with it. Like, you're watching the movie, and you're like, get on with it. And I don't know, I stayed awake for the entire movie. I wasn't really, you know, asleep or anything, but I can tell you this is the first movie I've ever seen in my life where there wasn't just one snoring, sleeping old man in the movie theater. There was two. There were two sleeping old men, one on my left and one on my right, a couple rows behind me, that were snoring extremely loudly, and it was starting to piss me off. I'm not going to lie to you. It was, because first they were snoring in stereo, and it kind of, you know, with these kind of films, like these horror movies where there are parts of the movie that have to stay quiet, it is one of those things where it, no, like, it just annoyed me. But that, you know, I tried to zone them out, and I did, and focused on the film. And it's just not a very good movie. There's a subplot in the movie that begins the film with Sarah Winchester's grandson. And I'm over here looking at it, and first of all, it looks like it's totally ripped off from Insidious. I mean, it's just the same, you know, haunted boy with the creepy eyes, not sure what's going on. He might be possessed and that whole thing. They're doing that over again. And I just felt like that plot went nowhere. And by the end of the film, I'm like, that's it? Like, they didn't even give you a payoff to that plot or really do anything with it. It's like, they give you clues like, okay, the ghosts are starting to get to this kid, and, you know, and you're thinking it's going to go in one direction, and then it just doesn't really pay off. It ends with, like, another character finding her bravery, which wasn't even really a subplot in the movie to begin with. It's like they toyed around with different subplots. Like, they had to have, like, development for these characters, but they almost just hammered home, like, just kind of at the end of the writing process, they just said, okay, well, let's figure out something for this character. Okay, well, she's going to be brave now. And what about the kid? Ah, it doesn't matter. You know, it's just a plot device. That kind of sucked. It really did. Besides just that, there were a couple of scenes that kind of were a little weird to me. Like, for example, there's a scene where Sarah Winchester gets hit in the shoulder with a rifle. Now, if you've ever been hit with a rifle before, it hurts. And she's an old woman, and she completely no-sells it until a few scenes later where she's all of a sudden selling it. Now, you could make the argument and say, oh, well, she was running on adrenaline, but she's not young. She's old, and it was a rifle shot right to the shoulder and collarbone. I just don't buy it. Like, I don't buy it being adrenaline. I just don't buy that. And also, I feel like her character knew too much. It's like, in the movie, she knew how to do certain things with these ghosts, how to contain these ghosts and control these ghosts, but they never explained, at least if they did explain it, hell, I missed it, they never explained how she knew how to do this. She just knew. Like, she just knew. And I'm pretty sure none of that was in the real story. The movie just felt like a two-hour episode of Are You Afraid of the Dark? Now, I love Are You Afraid of the Dark, okay? I grew up with that show. I'm not knocking it, but if you're watching a live-action, you know, theatrical film with Helen Mirren in it, you expect, like, better acting, better performances, better writing. Are You Afraid of the Dark was a kid's show, all right? No matter what you say, yes, it was great for its time. It was a kid's show. The movie just feels really sloppy, and she just knows everything, and it bugged me. Now, I don't hate this movie, though. I really didn't hate it. Like, I'm not angry at the movie. The last half of the movie is a lot of fun. There's a lot of interesting things that happen in the last half of the movie. A lot of action, a lot of good scares, you know, near the end. But there just weren't enough for me to give this a positive rating. I just can't give it. And it sucks because I love the idea that ghosts are mad at the creators of a weapon of destruction versus their killers. Like, I like that idea a lot, actually. It's a nice little twist on the traditional, you know, ghosts going after just the family because, well, they want to screw with them. There's actually a vendetta here. There are so many good ideas here and so much potential. And with these directors, you would think it would be a home run, but it just wasn't. It's almost like they just direct this movie in their sleep, man. And the movie just feels like it's made for home video. This is one of those made for DVD or made for Blu-ray movies that you get for like $5 in the Walmart bin. That's how the movie feels. And I hate saying that because I wanted it to be good. But it just, and again, it's not terrible. It's not a terrible movie. I'm not angry. This is not one of those films that got me emotionally upset when I left the theater. It just was just, eh. Like, I've seen this before. You know, we've all seen it before. But if you're going to check out this movie, I suggest waiting for Redbox, waiting for Netflix. Maybe give it some time if you're into it. But there's a movies like this, bro, there's a dime a dozen. And there's better ones out there. Insidious 4 had a lot of problems. A lot of plot contrivances. That's still in theaters, and that's a bit better than this. At least that movie wasn't boring. So check that out. And hey, go see Paddington, bro. How many times do I have to tell you to go see Paddington, damn it? But no, horror fans probably don't care about Paddington. Well, even if you're a horror fan, go see Paddington. I don't care. It's a good movie. But anyways, this movie, thumbs down, big letdown.